Guns, Germs, and Steel by Jared Diamond, Part 3, From Food to Guns, Germs, and Steel. In the second section, Diamond explained the ways in which food production contributed to differences in ancient societies. However, food production is not a proximate cause. It is only an ultimate cause, or a basic prerequisite, for certain other factors that directly determined modern differences. If a farmer and a hunter-gatherer fought each other one-on-one and naked, for example, neither one would have an advantage. The advantages that distinguish these two come from factors related to their different strategies for food production. Societies with agriculture have denser populations, breathe out bad germs, own better weapons, and live in centralized governments with elites who can start wars. This section of the book explores how the ultimate cause, food production, led to more proximate causes such as germs, literacy, technology, and centralized government. Diseases were a crucial proximate cause of domination by one society over another. In the majority of wars, most deaths were caused not by war, but by the exchange of diseases. So why was the exchange of nasty germs between Europe and the Americas so unequal? To answer this, Diamond first explains why some microbes make us sick and others don't, why many diseases cause epidemics, and how diseases pass between humans and animals. Germs make us sick in order to pass themselves from one host to another. For example, coughing is a strategy by which a germ can transfer through the air to a new host. Germs, of course, want sick people to cough to make sure that they have enough available hosts to stay alive. In an epidemic, germs are quick and deadly and can kill normally healthy individuals. Over time, human populations exposed to a germ came to have a high number of people with genes that resist it. They were selected for survival of such epidemics. This kind of crowd disease can only continue in large populations, where there are enough people for the germs to continue to pass themselves along. Otherwise, the germs would quickly die out, as all people in the society died out. In large hunter-gatherer societies, of course, such diseases would very quickly kill everyone and therefore die out as well. For this reason, new crowd diseases do not develop in small societies. Hunter-gatherer tribes do not have enough population density to create their own deadly diseases that they could pass to larger sedentary societies. Moreover, human proximity to domesticated livestock is what caused certain deadly germs to develop in sedentary food-producing societies instead of hunter-gatherer communities. Animals carry a number of germs that were first passed on to humans in a variety of ways. In fact, many deadly diseases, such as smallpox and AIDS, first originated with animals and then spread to humans, in a new form, through human contact with these animals. Of course, these germs were most likely to be passed along to humans who kept domesticated animals and lived closely together with them. These conditions were most common in food-producing societies with a sedentary lifestyle. Overall, it was populations higher in density and with greater contact with domesticated animals that developed the deadliest diseases and were able to spread them to societies that couldn't cope with them. This was how Europeans developed the smallpox that would destroy Native Americans. It also explains why Native Americans did not develop diseases of the same scale that could kill European populations. Writing was also first developed in some societies and not others, and brought these communities several important advantages. Writing made it possible to transmit knowledge accurately, in greater quantity and detail, across space and time. But why did no traditional hunter-gatherers adopt writing? Actually, very few people invented writing completely on their own throughout history. The Sumerians in Mesopotamia, Mexican Indians, Egyptians, and the Chinese. Whether or not a given society developed or adopted writing depended on whether they would find it useful and whether they could support specialists who acted as scribes. These conditions only existed in societies that had complex and centralized political institutions. This kind of political institution was supported by the ultimate cause of food production. Food production was a necessary condition for the adoption of writing, but not a sufficient condition. Some societies that were very isolated because of their geographic barriers also failed to adopt writing because the invention had trouble reaching them. The history of writing strengthens the importance of geography and ecology to the spread of human inventions. The spread of technology can also be confusing to historians. Archaeologists in Crete recently discovered the Phytos disc, dating from 1700 BCE. The disc seemed to be used as a stamp for producing written documents and anticipated humanity's invention of printing. But we know this technology was not widely adopted in the area for many more years. Why was this disc not immediately influential? Why did it take so much longer for these societies to adopt printing technology? Such questions suggest how unpredictable the spread of technology can seem. In fact, most inventions were developed not in response to a demand for a new product, but simply out of experimentation or curiosity. Diamond argues that invention is the mother of necessity, and not the other way around. For example, Thomas Edison's phonograph was first meant to preserve last words, record books for blind people, etc. None of these uses seem to have commercial value, but once he started to offer them, other people found a popular use for them, recording and playing music. Technology finds most of its uses after it has been invented, rather than being invented in order to meet a need. Technology develops cumulatively, meaning it requires contributions from several people and organizations, instead of in individual actions. Individual geniuses are also as important. It is how a society responds to a new product that determines the importance of any invention. Also, most things we think a single person invented actually followed previous work of other inventors who had developed earlier prototypes or parts of the resulting technology. No one person worked alone to change an entire society. Even though we hear about many famous inventors, especially from Europe, Europe did not actually have more individual geniuses than other societies. It simply had more inventions we hear about today because societies recognized their uses and made them popular. Four factors influence whether an invention is accepted: relative economic advantage compared with existing technology, social value and prestige, compatibility with what companies want, and how obvious its advantages are. But how do different societies accept innovation? Historians of technology have proposed many factors. These include life expectancy, which gives potential inventors more time to work on their products. Five factors relate to the organization of society: the availability of slave labor that freed up time for others to focus on technology, patents and property laws that rewarded innovation, opportunities for technical training, a capitalist model that rewarded investment in technological development, and the individualism of a society that allowed inventors to profit from their own work. Four other factors are ideological: risk-taking behavior, a scientific outlook, tolerance of diverse views, and religions that encourage innovation. But none of these factors relate to geography or address ultimate factors. Perhaps the amount and variety of different factors helps to explain the patterns of the spread of technology. In fact, the development and reception of inventions varied a lot from society to society on the same continent, and over time within the same society. It is therefore impossible to claim that any group of people has simply always been more backwards. We must look to broad patterns instead of specific examples in order to understand the spread of inventions. So, what are the most important factors for the adoption of a new technology in a society? New inventions tend to appear when either other societies learn of inventions elsewhere, are receptive to it, and adopt it, or a society lacks an invention that exists nearby and finds itself at a disadvantage. For example, the Maori tribes that adopted muskets were able to subjugate the tribes that did not adopt this new technology. Societies that are geographically isolated can even adopt and then abandon a technology. For example, Japan briefly adopted guns before abandoning them soon after, which was possible only because it was an isolated island that could not easily be overwhelmed by neighbors who did not have guns. If a location is isolated, it is less likely to get and keep technologies. Technology also spreads by diffusion, meaning that one small invention can lead to later inventions that build on this original model. This means that those societies that adopted new technologies very early had an advantage in inventing more and more complex technologies later. Sedentary societies were better able to do this because they could hold on to possessions, develop specialized roles, and had more people who could potentially contribute new inventions. In conclusion, it was Eurasia's distinctive geography that led it to develop more inventions, which allowed it to overwhelm other, more isolated hunter-gatherer societies. Government and religion are two other factors that often go together. They can determine the structure and power of a society. Human societies have generally progressed in order from bands, small groups consisting of 5 to 80 people, to tribes, hundreds of people living in fixed settlements, to chiefdoms, several thousands of people with established hierarchies, to states, which had an even more complex political structure. In these larger and more complex societies, where power was typically concentrated in a single leader, societal organization was more complex. An important challenge also came. How did leaders, like chiefs or kings, motivate their followers to keep them in power and obey them? They could either take away weapons from the public and give them to the elites, or redistribute respect in ways that kept the masses happy, or use their monopoly of force to keep order and reduce violence, or create an ideology or religion that justified their rule. This last option explains why so many complex societies also developed a religion. Religion also brings two other important benefits to centralized societies. It helps unrelated individuals to live together without killing one another by giving them a connection to each other not based on family and close friends, and it gives people a motivation to sacrifice their lives for others. Both of these benefits helped these religious societies to work together and conquer other, less religious or centralized communities. Size can predict the kind of complexity that also leads societies to develop religion, technology, writing, or diseases.